Right. Quick question. When was the last time that you had goosebumps? I want you to really think about that. Like, think really, really carefully. At what point did you last have that sensation? One second. Whilst I'm setting up, I want you to think about that because I might ask you what yours is. And goosebumps is normally a triangulation of several different things. It can be a place, it can be a person, it can be often a combination of things that are sensory and, if you like, circumstantial. And it's that triangulation. Now, my challenge to myself and my promise to you is I'm going to give you goosebumps in 15 minutes time. Unfortunately, I can't use the shortest routes to goosebumps, which are some of which are unmentionable, or food, because I can't cook from here particularly well. But I'm going to try to do this for you. And I want to try and do that by telling you a story. And it's something that's happened to me recently. And this is not the keynote that I intended to give today, which should make you and me quite nervous. But I don't get nervous, so that's going to be your problem, not mine. I'll tell you a little story. Get this working. I'm going to give you two examples of goosebumps in my life. I was lucky enough to play on stage with this guy. Anyone know who that is, by the way? You don't have to put your hand up. We're not at school. Yes? Correct. Jeff Buckley. Jeff Buckley was probably the most perfect human storm of charisma, presence, sexiness, musicality, everything rolled into the most annoyingly good-looking package you've ever seen in your life. I kind of saw this man and thought, I hate you so much right now. You, not only are you the living embodiment of James Dean, but you're also the best musician, the greatest musician I've ever played with in my entire life. I sat on stage with him and played with him in his last ever concert in Europe. Weeks later, he swam out into the Mississippi and he was taken from us. But sitting on stage, if I think about that now, I don't know if you can see, but I have goosebumps, because for me, that was a point when you're next to somebody who's transcending themselves. They're becoming other. And he's somebody who burnt very strong, and he probably lived 100 years in 25. This one's a little closer to home. Goosebumps are often mundane, but sometimes they're mundane and a bit cool. My daughter will kill me for showing this photograph, because she now looks like a sort of a model. She doesn't get her looks from me. And she was challenged at school with a new American import, the show and tell. I mean, this is not an English thing. Number one, don't show, and please don't tell. Yeah? It's like prom. What the fuck is that? I mean, they used to be called balls. Anyway, let's not go into that. And so she said, Dad, I've got to do show and tell. It's a new thing at school. And, oh, gosh, okay. I said, well, what do you want to do? She said, I'm going to write a piece of music. I said, great, perfect. So she sat down. I said, and what's the show and tell? But she said, we're going to send it into space. I said, oh, okay. You don't say no. Just don't say no to your children, okay? So sure enough, she wrote a little piece and she sent it into space. And the teacher came up to me after school. She said, Mr. Sheppard, your daughter has got an overactive imagination. Now, the goosebumps weren't just in the fact that my daughter had written a piece of music, but they're in the fact that thanks to dear Mike Hawley, one of my friends, there's an astronaut called Katie Coleman who plays the flute. Astronauts have got email addresses. You can send a piece of music into space, and if you've got an astronaut friend who plays the flute, they'll play it for you in space and then send you a photograph. So I took great pleasure in saying to the teacher, maybe you've got an underactive imagination. That gives me goosebumps. And by the way, fuck you. I'm sorry for the F-bombs. If the rabbi can drop the F-bomb, so can we all. Thank you. Anyway, goosebumps are central to a very important piece of 20th century bullshit research. 20th century piece of research. If you've ever had kids and you've played the Mozart because it makes them more intelligent, you are guilty. You are guilty of something very terrible, which is you've been influenced by Disney to believe that if you play Mozart, particularly the two piano sonata by Mozart to your darling little children, that this will make them more intelligent. Now, playing Mozart to your children makes them intelligent, like me watching the Olympics makes me Usain Bolt. You don't need to laugh, that's not very kind. I've watched a lot of Olympics, and I'm not quite at Quentin's level of musculature yet. But in researching this amazing non-effect, they decided they would play lots of music to lots of subjects. So there was a fantastic neurologist called Jak Panksepp who decided to set up this study, and they played the Mozart to these subjects. Nothing happened. Total disinterest. And I thought, well, let's change the dial a little bit. So they played The Final Cut by Pink Floyd. And as one, at a particular chord sequence, a cycle of fifths, they all ruffled their feathers simultaneously. I didn't mention, did I? These were chickens. This is a musically sensitive chicken. And all of those chickens, they rewound the music and they played it to them again. And the same thing happened. They all got simultaneously goosebumps. Sorry. Blame the rabbi. Now, what's happening there is that it's kind of, yeah, we like being in a flock. There's something about being in an audience reacting to music that is visceral and that for some reason has this sort of hardwire to us. It's like, you know, whether you're dancing to the music, you don't want to see me do that, or whether you're just sort of singing along. I mean, that's obviously that Freddie Mercury going, "Hey!" And you're like, "Oh!" I mean, that's primal. You can't help yourself. Nobody said, "Please sing this back after four." Everyone just does it. And the bigger the crowd, the more that's going to happen. I have goosebumps thinking about that. I don't know if anyone's old enough to have watched it at the time. I did. That's an amazing point of triangulation. Time, place, insane talent, motive. Everything, it's perfect. And at that point, your body will print chills. Even if you just watched it on TV, even if you just saw the simulation of it in that recent brilliant film. So what on earth are we doing making music a consumable? Why are we now basically sort of going, "Oh, what shall I listen to? Okay. Oh, I can listen to anything in the world." Well, it's Ed Sheeran, I guess. Why? Music's hardwired into us. It's only since bloody Thomas Edison have we realized that actually it's much easier just to be consumers and we can just listen to stuff. That's not what music is for. I've got some theories about music. Bear with me. I seriously believe that music can become like a metaphorical landscape in your mind for things that you can't necessarily express verbally or rationalize. I know I'm speaking quickly with a British accent, I'm sorry, I'm very excited about this. I've been introduced to this concept only a couple of weeks ago by a friend, that actually when somebody asks the worst question in the world, particularly in England, which is, "How are you?" Number one, they don't want to know. Yeah, they don't, I'm sorry. How are you? Fine. Fine is the second worst word in the English language. But actually, the answer is impossible to give, honestly, because actually, we all exist in a state of 2, 3, 4, 5 things at the same time. I love this painting. This is by Caspar David Friedrich, and it's called The Wanderer. And it's this guy kind of who's clearly having a kind of Hollywood moment before film in a sort of soundtrack of his own life. If I zoom out, you'll probably recognize the photo, the painting more recently. He's kind of having a Freddie Mercury moment there. Because he's sort of thinking, in the context of this, I feel my significance, I feel my insignificance. But at the same time, there's so much going on in that. It's not I'm lonely, it's maybe I'm epic, or maybe I'm feeling heroic, or maybe I'm Germanically melancholic, that's more likely. But you could imagine how, if I'm a movie composer, you can imagine how you could have to represent that musically. Well, I don't know, those if only I had a device I could do this with. This is digital technology, because you use your fingers. It's digital. Get over it. So let's say, for instance, if we were to try to make this layered, and if I were to take this as being, imagine this was a movie, I'm trying to express more than one thing at the same time, then it might be, I'll always look at the soundscape first, the clouds, so that might be something like this. I'm not going to use the chair. Why not? Like this. that's your clouds. Now you notice that the hillside's a little bit more moderate there. So let's add in the hillside. Sound like some of this. Birds going on as well, so let's put them in. Shut up. All of that can coexist. Now, the answer to that of how you're feeling might be all of those things at the same time. And I think that's what music does. It can actually represent this whole chaos of everything. But weirdly enough, I'm just making that stuff up, but that sounds like it sort of makes sense, because your brain can kind of think, yeah, there's that busy stuff there, here's that floaty stuff there, there's that sort of landscapey thing there. At no point you're thinking to yourself, yeah, but how is it feeling? Which one do I listen to? Get over it. All of it. It's fine. That's how music works. And I actually think that sometimes music can mirror our extraordinarily complex human condition, because it can do lots of things at the same time. It doesn't matter about genre, by the way. I mean, I don't know what that was. It was post something or other. Let's say it was post-classical. It was the first and last performance of that piece. Let's just be very clear about that. But it goes beyond this sense of sort of linear thought and absolutist, how are you? Fine. All right. Yeah, I'm kind of feeling like that. And I think for us, when we do use music sometimes and listen to it, we like to think that we're sort of, it's creating a soundtrack to our day. Maybe we're the hero in that moment of our life. We've all had that moment, you're driving the car, the piece of music comes on, you think, I am James Bond right now. I'm driving a hire car that could seat 9 people and it's going 35 miles an hour, but I'm still Bond. And that's, why do I always get a massive car from National? I don't know. Anyway. So I thought about this and I thought, I know lots of clever people. I think we can maybe reverse this and turn it on its head. Now, being a composer, I develop what's called a studio tan. Now, a studio tan is when you spend so long indoors that you become so pale that you become transparent. So to fight the studio tan, you try and spend at least a fraction of the day outside in the woods, forest bathing, as the Japanese call it, love it. But when I go out there, I don't know what to listen to. I have this crisis of there's all this damn music and suddenly I'm a consumer, but my job is actually putting sound to picture of people doing things. We've got all this technology, why can't we make that just work? It can't be that hard. So I wrote a little algorithm and started thinking about this. And took this idea that maybe if you treat little blocks of music as being kind of like Lego blocks, then you can deconstruct them and find different ways to put them together. You know, you might buy a car as a Lego kit, but it's going to turn into some mutant monster by the time you've finished with it. So I thought, okay, I'll do that, and then started putting a team together to do this. This is Tom Gruber, who Mike Hawley introduced me to 12 years ago. Thanks, Mike. We're at Abbey Road. Abbey Road hosted us, and we're now based there because they seem to think this ridiculous idea might work. And we started doing serious recording sessions. This is my friend Stefano, who's got the greatest tattoo in the world. He bleeds music if you cut him. He's number one in the charts at the moment because his remix of Abbey Road, the 50th anniversary album, he's the guy entrusted by the Beatles, so he knows what he's doing. And we'd signed a couple of contracts quite quickly with people who wanted to find ways of using this, I don't know, for walking, driving, whatever, which is fine. And we got into the studio, and our metric is TTG. Now, TTG stands for time to goosebumps. How long will it take you to get to goosebumps? I'm very proud of this metric because it's actually something you can measure. Because you put a demo in someone's hand, and they'll either go, mm-hmm, or they go, ooh. And you try and time. You want to get that within about 15 seconds, okay? I was going to show you the process of doing this, which I've never really shown anybody. So this is getting the orchestra into the studio. This is Studio 3, where The Final Cut by Pink Floyd was recorded. See what's going on here? There's a pattern. And this is my orchestra just preparing to do a take. Very silent, very quiet. Recognize that? I just played it to you. Right, there we go. And I saw that that's all right. It's missing something. Do you know what's missing? It's missing feel. So let's do take two. So we do take two. And that sounds like this. Very quiet. Now, you may not hear the difference, but I basically told them to think the sexiest thing they could on the third note. And what happens with that is you've then got a little building block. You can start to stack these building blocks and reassemble them. It's a bit like if you're going to open a restaurant, why not source the world's greatest olive oil, flour? Make those ingredients really super, super rich. And that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to make our Lego blocks kind of really deep and rich. But we are trying to stack the deck as well. So I kind of thought, I'll ring up this guy. He's called Guy. He's actually the bass player on Bad. He's Michael Jackson's favorite. He was Michael Jackson's favorite bass player. Madonna's go-to bass player as well. He's got some stories, I can tell you. Oh, and he's the bass player in Pink Floyd. So we thought we'd just kind of stack the odds in our favor a little bit and get him to record another track as well. I got quite excited about this, as you can probably tell. And Guy's like, yeah, I'll do it. Why not? Didn't ask what the fee was, like, that sounds cool, I'm in. And he's joined our team, which is kind of nice, and we're getting some other people in of his level. Anyway, scroll forward now. We've then got a situation where we've got a demo that works, that now if I walk in the woods, this is taking all those Lego blocks and stacking together with some of the outside noises in the forest near my house. And what you just heard is in here with the bass player, with various other musicians. But when I'm walking, this is making music from scratch, by the way. If I turn left, I want the music to change. I want it to actually soundtrack my day. Now, it could be that you think, well, let's not make it sort of affected by direction. Let's say if the weather changes.
Oh, it's raining.
Awesome. We can take... Your device knows that. Even your car knows if it's raining. If you change direction, you want it to change key. You want other instruments to come in. That's a guitar player into the Spider-Verse. He said yes to. And it will basically react in real time, creating new music as it goes along. Anyway, that's kind of what we started doing. And it's kind of got a little out of control because we've realized even from 2 hours of blocks that you record, you can get 2.5 billion permutations. And we're looking to record about 30 or 40 days worth of material. And the idea is that it makes anyone who uses it a producer, not a consumer. But that's all fine. And this was sort of getting very exciting. And I thought, I think we know what we're going to do with this. And I was building this in my studio, putting all those little bits together, feeling like a sort of mad scientist, thinking, oh, this is good. We're going to try and give people goosebumps. Marvelous. Great. So Wednesday, 25th of September, this is my son. My son, I hear the keys in the door. Yeah, he doesn't always dress like this. Not now. I hear the keys in the door. My son, who's 12, he's brought a girl home. I'm like, oh, okay. And I can see him look at me like, Dad, be cool. Because up to this point, girls are stupid. And he's like, just please, don't embarrass me. Please don't embarrass me. And I have goosebumps all over because I think, oh, it's kind of cute. And this girl, she's lovely. She notices my cello propped up in the corner, and she says, huh, do you play the cello? And I said, yep. She looks me dead in the eyes. She says, what grade are you? That means, like, what level are you in England? Like, grade 8's the top level. And I said, well, what grade are you? She said, I'm grade 4. And I went, whoa, okay. I said, I'm a little bit ahead of that. And I could see my son going, Don't say anything. No, like, all right, we're cool. I was like, I desperate to tell her. So no, we'll just leave it there. But this is not the talk I planned for you, as I said. I'm in America, Sunday the 29th of September, and I never check Facebook. And there's this message, pops up a messenger for someone who's not linked to me, and you know if you're ever so slightly prominent in any field, never open those messages. I get death threats for various things. It's just not worth it. I open it because it's 3 o'clock in the morning. I'm jet lagged and I think, oh, whatever, I'll engage. And I don't recognize the surname. And it's a lady writing. She says, you don't know me. I'm listening to your music. My daughter plays it a lot in the house. I'm listening to a piece called I Am Alive. I'm like, oh, gosh, okay. That piece means a lot to me. She said, you don't know me, but my daughter's got she's had a subdural empyema, it's a trachoma, a stroke, and it really hits me. Goosebumps. Bad, bad, bad goosebumps. Now, the piece she was referring to, I'm Alive, was written for a friend of mine called Emily Levine. And I was like, oh God, for God's sake, don't read the notes I wrote for that piece, because Emily was a really dear friend of mine who had a very intensive correspondence with when she fully accepted the fact that she was going to die at an advanced age, and she was a comic philosopher who Mike Hawley introduced me to. There's a pattern here, isn't there? And she was amazing. She was the most gorgeous woman. These messages kind of kept coming, and she said, well, the mum was saying this, we've been playing your music to her ever since she went under. I was like, oh God. Hard to talk about. And she said, but also the music is untangling me. I thought, oh God, what a thing to write. That's incredible. And I was thinking, well, Emily, this is my friend Emily, and she had this amazing quote. She said, you're given this amazing gift, life. And we've heard this actually on day one from Saul. You enrich it as best as you can, and then you give it back. That was totally a philosophy, and she died the happiest death. But she was ready. She'd done everything. And I loved this woman. She was amazing. But I couldn't possibly let this mother know that this is the music that I'd written for my friend to die. So please don't read it. Emily also said reality comes into being through interaction, like a triangulation. See the pattern here? The girl in question was called Inara Hussain. She's 12 years old. She was my son's friend. And I realized that 4 days after she'd been over to my house, my cello rival, triple brain surgery. And on Tuesday, the 1st of October, the family were told to gather together to say goodbye to her. She was still being played music 24/7, and I literally didn't know what to do. I thought, this is private, and being English, you sort of think, you know, we're sort of talking about passing away. Do you step away, or do you engage? Oh, I don't know. I literally don't know what to do. Anyway, she stabilized. She didn't pass away. And I thought, when I got back from America, I thought, I'm going to ask the family, can I come in and see her? So, Sunday the 6th of October, we're holding hands. She wasn't there. She just wasn't there. She hadn't died. She wasn't there. Now, the family have asked me to share this. And I'm going to give you no context to it, apart from the fact that the music that I played you before, which is my friends in the orchestra, members of Pink Floyd and stuff, is what we took in and played the cello with it to her. And at this point, they didn't know if her brain was connected with her body, really. They didn't know what was going on there. She had triple surgery. We felt there was some movement in her hand. And if you can bear with me, the family have asked me to play this. Just watch really So something really coincidental happened, which is she moved her legs and she rolled towards the music. And I don't know science at all. And because she's a cellist, I think something may have connected. We just don't know. The neurologist who was there said, she's shivering. I was like, well, is she cold? And he said, no, she's having goosebumps. Shit. So that was good. So went back the next Sunday, and they brought in her cello bow, which was great. And she was, one of the eyes was open, and I sat and played a Viva La Vida by Coldplay, and she's like, I need to not play sad, slow music to her. And we put the bow in her hand, and she was like this. Like, sleep bowing like her life depended on it. Maybe it did, I don't know. And I said to her, show me your bow hold, perfect bow hold. Now, this is weird, right? This is like, the brain's obviously kind of going, cello's all still in there, the music's all fully still in there. And she was kids are strong. 12-year-olds are like oxes, right? This girl is, Inara Hussein is strong. I love this girl. She's so strong. I held my cello up to her with a loop pedal. I said, go on, pluck me an A string. She's like, did it. Okay, G, G, C, C, D. And we made a little piece together. We looped a little piece together. This story gets better because on Monday, friends reunited. And I said, and the family wanted me to bring this to you because they think they want to understand how music can, well, music obviously touches something here. It doesn't have to be my music or our music. Music clearly is hardwired into this girl, and it might be a way of getting her nearer and nearer to the surface all of the time. So I asked her if she had a message for everyone, and it was very simple. She just wants to say hello to everyone, and she's really grateful for you to listen to her story. Do you have goosebumps, by the way? There we go, promised you. I also asked her three questions, which is this. I said to her, do you like the cello? Great. Do you love music? Do you love the violin? Good girl. We realize she can talk, but she saves it for people like my son, people her own age. And if school teachers come around, she's like, she just signs them, right? It's brilliant. Her sense of humor is astounding. So here's a question. I don't know any of the science that might be going on. I have no idea. But what if music might have a role to play in that first line of treatment, in that kind of triage level? You know, what other areas should we be looking at? What, you know, opioid addiction, depression, mindfulness, maybe helping with people with autism, aid focus, you know, sort of focus, mindfulness, whatever. We're talking to memory villages in the UK who are Alzheimer's organisations about being built into the houses to help people kind of pattern their movements. But we don't know. We need the science and we need people to help us because we've got all these, yes, we've got commercial clients. I want to unlock this stuff that we're recording anyway and kind of go, here you go. Please have it. Please use it. We heard something hilarious from the hospital, which was the intensive care unit that would be, that I'd taken the music into the first place. Other parents had asked for the music, and apparently gone viral in the ICU, which is something you never want to do. There's always a time for sick humor, it's fine. So to finish with, last 2 minutes, I think that we used to only have God, but she's a bit busy now. And I think then we had science, which, you know, if you read your Bible, it's kind of physician heal thyself. Our duty is actually to bring the doctoring in. But I think we've got science and art is the unlocked mystery. Everyone in this room knows. There's so much that we don't know. And maybe there's a way whereby we can go to subscription rather than prescription. Like imagine if an arts organization could get FDA approval. Imagine if an orchestra could be FDA approved. I know it goes against Big Pharma, but screw them. Music's free, and it's hardwired into us. Now, a lot of people in this room have made all of this happened and actually made that happen the other day. Whether it's coincidence or not, I don't care. You know who you are. Thank you so much. And returning to my biggest goosebumps of my life, apart from that other Sunday, is I'd like to play Hallelujah for you, to say thank you. And listen to the layers. Just listen to the layers. Thank you so much. Stage.
Thank you.